Good evening and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Aaron Dykes, your host for tonight. This is Wednesday, April 4th, 2012, and we'll be right back with the news.
Tonight on the InfoWars Nightly News, the Obama administration is preparing to sue Arizona County Sheriff Joe Arpaio, claiming that his department violated civil rights laws by improperly targeting Latinos to crack down on illegal immigrants. Could this be payback for the Arpaio investigation into Obama's fake birth certificate? Then, new research reveals that whooping cough outbreaks are higher among children already vaccinated, but the mainstream media spins the story to protect Big Pharma. What on earth is going on in Wisconsin? Yet another town reports strange booms and flashes of light. But don't be alarmed, the federal government says there is nothing to worry about. And finally, after exposing climate fascist Kerry Norgaard, YouTube censors the Alex Jones channel. Alex gets an update from Mark Moreno on the Green Police and their continuous attacks on our free speech. Plus, more of today's top headlines, and Jason Burmis joins us live via video Skype. It's 1776 Worldwide.
And so now we'll get into our top story. The government is targeting Sheriff Joe Arpaio for his targeting of Latinos, an ongoing battle supposedly just over illegal immigration and the questions of whether they're enforcing things properly. You see, his high-profile crackdown on illegal immigrants has drawn ire and on and on and on. Of course, it has nothing to do with the fact that Arpaio has a cold case posse investigating the president's very own Providence, the authenticity of his birth certificate documents or of other documents like that Selective Service card that is apparently fraudulent, according to what they found in their investigation. Of course, there's been a lot of back and forth over all these factors, and you've got basically Arizona going against the federal government on so many issues. Don't forget to check out, of course, our exclusive interview with Sheriff Joe Arpaio, members of his cold case posse, people like Jerome Corsi, the extreme birth certificate investigator who has so much info that we put out last week. But meanwhile, you've got Homeland Security now wanting to grant illegal aliens unlawful presence waivers. So it's not just about the laws on the books in regards to illegal immigration, as imperfect as they are. You've got the feds actively wanting to bring in more illegal aliens, give them waivers as they crack down on Americans, put them under suspicion for ordinary behavior and suspected activities of various kinds. Now, in other news, vaccine failure is admitted, as you have whooping cough outbreaks admittedly tied to children who did receive the vaccinations in question and not tied to children who were exempted from the vaccinations. Mike Adams has the report. For several years, he says Natural News has maintained that many vaccines actually cause the very infectious diseases they claim to prevent. Measles vaccines, for example, actually cause measles. Flu shots actually cause an increase in susceptibility to the flu. And now we have an open admission precisely to the point. He, of course, cites directly from a Reuters report where they cite a spike in cases around the Kaiser Permanente in San Rafael, the largest whooping cough outbreak in more than 50 years. And despite their expectations, it was not tied to unvaccinated kids. Instead, they were surprised that the majority of cases were in fully vaccinated children, and it caught their attention. And it goes on from there. But of course, they still tell you in the same report to take the vaccine anyway, even though they admit there's been no long-term testing for effectiveness or for safety. And they basically admit that it's not going to work in the long term. You've got other people like Alan Phillips, the attorney, who's shown where you have something like a 15% ineffective rate from vaccinated children and only a 1% kind of outbreak rate among those who refuse to get the vaccines. So all the numbers are cooked. It's just the government wants to push these vaccines on you. I really doubt they're actually that concerned about containing the disease themselves. What they want is compliance with the system. Meanwhile, compliance with the system continues to show that those in authority are the greatest dangers. That's at least if you focus on the TSA situation. Foundation. Now a screener has been caught throwing hot coffee in a pilot's face after the pilot asked her to stop using the N-word and to refrain from profanity in their conversation because of all the children around and the general professional ethics that normally would apply to almost any profession, but somehow not to TSA. So this agent became very upset when pilot Steve Trivett began to lecture him and threw the coffee. Letitia L. was reportedly arrested and charged with harassment and misdemeanor assault. And it just goes on with the larger God complex of the TSA agents who think that a uniform gives them power, that they're personally charged with this rush of energy and that the uniform they wear doesn't just reflect an overbearing system. You know how that story goes. Rape cases, stealing from luggage, smuggling drugs, child kidnapping, trafficking, and all the rest of it. Scolding reply at JFK was the headline in the New York Post. That's an interesting headline. Turning to other types of spying on the public and putting them through the rigmarole, even Congress wants to know what the NSA is doing with the $2 billion Utah Spy Center. You saw the recent headlines, Wired Magazine and all the other big publications about how nothing will be secret anymore. All the public's data will basically be run through this big system. One senior intelligence official formerly involved with the project going on at the Utah Data Collection Center said that this is more than just a data center. It's a code-breaking megalopolis, the likes of which the world has never seen. And of course, it's already been admitted that through the massive amounts of data that we give the government and the private agencies online and that they take from us without asking, they're going to be linking financial information, stock trades, business deals, personal phone calls, confidential communications, along with legal documents, foreign and military diplomatic secrets, and everything. It'll all be tied to your name or to your various user identities online or in the private sector, whatever the case may be in the physical world. Anyway, General Keith Alexander, the current head of the National Security Agency, the NSA, also the current head of U.S. Cyber Command, testified before Congress last week. He denied. What did he deny? He denied the facility would be spying on American citizens, claimed they don't even have the capability to spy on citizens, and they're not authorized to do so anyway. It's pretty clear, though, that they do have that capability. It's all here in Robert Johnson's report in the Business Insider and the other sources. One thing they admittedly do is where they have a mandate restriction, just like the CIA, where it says you can't spy on Americans. Well, they outsource it to foreign governments they have alliances and partnerships with, and they spy on Americans, and then they secretly share the data or things are accidentally linked and on and on. General Keith Alexander, of course, is one to keep an eye on. He's been to the past four or five Bilderberg meetings without fail. They've had cybersecurity on the agenda for the past several years without fail. He's certain to be there again this year. And you can bet that shutting down the freedom of the internet will be on the agenda, as well as will be the unfolding surveillance agenda as we discuss here. Meanwhile, in WorldNet Daily, Nat Hentoff discusses how Obama's NSA is close to knowing all about us. Of course, they get Obama in the headline, but they go on to admit that no matter who is the commander-in-chief, this spying is getting really out of control. But most recently, the GAO's a government accountability project has uncovered that Attorney General Eric Holder, a favorite official now, has publicly declared new guidelines that will permit the federal counterterrorism investigators to collect, search, and store data about Americans who are not suspected of terrorism or anything, but they're going to be looking for suspicious patterns. And what is suspicious? What do they suspect Americans of even doing? Well, that's classified, says this report, but we basically know. We've had the MIAC report, we've had the Homeland Security reports, and all the other reports mixed in from years past and the past several years, just proving that political activity is enough to have you considered a potential terrorist. Being a returning veteran is enough for you to be classified a potential terrorist, and everything in between, lemonade stands and all the rest of it. You've seen the headlines, and it's clear when they track this amount of data, they're going to apply it to society in general because they want to track mass patterns, but they have to have an excuse. So terrorism is an easy throwaway. You don't have to get specific. You can't give away the details because it's classified, and you can just spy on everyone. And they begin to to, well, they didn't even uncover the NSA till 1975 when Frank Church, who gave his name to the Church Committee that in part investigated the CIA and the JFK assassination, became very concerned about it and his capability to end privacy forever in American society to where there would be no hiding from the kind of data being collected. Once complete, the Utah Data Center, the thing we're talking about concurrently, is expected to be fully operational by September 13. It will be the last link in the chain of the electronic concentration camp that surrounds us, said Rutherford.org, who's been tracking this recent situation. So it's just incredible the amount of data they put together, the kind of spying that's going on, and how far things have gone. And Jason Burmis, of course, is coming up later to discuss other aspects of our completely eroding privacy. You remember, of course, when Michael Hayden, who was at the same time director of the CIA and director of the NSA, boldfacedly told a reporter that no, the Fourth Amendment doesn't say you have to have a warrant. No, the Fourth Amendment only says reasonable. No, it doesn't say probable cause. It doesn't say any of that, even though the exact text was quoted to him and he surely knows what's in the Bill of Rights, which is on paper precisely to contain government's overreach of powers. And but that's all being pissed away, isn't it? Meanwhile, another Wisconsin town reports strange booms and flashes of lights. Barra Boo in Wisconsin, a little more than 100 miles south of Clintonville, where other strange booms were seen last week. It also happened in Montello, Wisconsin, all within a close proximity. And at least in Baraboo, and I believe in the other cities, they've checked the patterns for anything in the weather that could have caused it. They've contacted the national, local, and state weather services. They don't see anything that would have caused these odd booms that were, in fact, in the Clintonville case, caught on camera. And you've got the chief of police in Baraboo saying, we don't know if we have a Clintonville going on here or what. But basically that it is strange. People saw a large flash of lights accompanying the boom, and it's just not weather related. We don't know, of course, what's going on, but there are a number of alternative explanations that could be suspected. I was surprised to read that CO2 sequestration could be a possible explanation. I'd like to know more about that. But also, of course, we know fracking has become a very controversial but widespread practice where they tap into the ground to try to extract the natural gas. That has been blamed on some small and medium-sized earthquakes, as, of course, has been HARP, the high-frequency active auroral research program, which has a lot of criticism, and people trying to monitor it and figure out what's going on may also be something like secret underground military tunneling. But what we know is, if it is one of those explanations or something else, they're not going to tell us what's going on. But again and again, where seemingly bizarre explanations have been put forward, many of them prove to be at least plausible, even if you can't link it to a smoking gun. It'd be interesting to see what is going on in Wisconsin, what kind of secret things are going on there, since it's clearly nothing above board. Meanwhile, in financial news, CNBC.com reports why the Fed will intervene if stocks fall too far. Mr. Bernanke and former Fed Chair Alan Greenspan made it clear that the stock market is in the transmission mechanism for monetary policy, said Quincy Crosby, chief market strategist at Prudential Annuities. They know a stronger shock in the market tends to feeds into a stronger economy and feeds into investor confidence. But basically, it breaks down to how since the 2008 financial crisis, almost $3 trillion have been put on the Fed's balance sheets, and through QE1 and QE2 and the silent but deadly QE3s ongoing, they've been extending market liquidity to investors. That's been ricocheted and projected into the stock market. And really, does the stock market reflect reality at all? It's just this market confidence tool to keep the public from freaking out, which is why they may continue to send those signals, even though they've said they're no longer going to provide this cheap liquidity. Interesting quote here from Bill Gross, the CEO of bond giant PIMCO. When QE1 has ended, when QE2 has ended, basically the stock market has gone down by 1,500 points in the next month or two. Is the Fed trapped in this conundrum of providing cheaper liquidity in order to pump up the stock market and risk markets? I think they are. I won't argue whether it's good policy, but it's necessary policy based on where central banks have led us, right into the jaws of control, a centralized economy, all on the idea of keeping up this projected stock market image and never building a true recovery, not empowering Main Street, only empowering Wall Street predators who just want to do these crazy bets and occupy our economy. So we'll turn now to the quote of the day. And of course, we have two powerful interviews coming up. Government is not reason. It is not eloquent. It is force. Like fire, it is a dangerous servant and a fearful master. That, of course, was George Washington. And, of course, stay tuned because we have two great, powerful interviews coming up. Alex Jones will talk to Mark Morano of the Climate Depot about the censorship on YouTube that our own channel's experiencing and the larger idea that you can't criticize people telling you to shut down human behavior, to shut down the economy, to shut down your very free speech, all because of carbon credits. But if you criticize them, that somehow is a violation of their little personal privacy, of their integrity. You'll hear about it all from Alex. You know he's more eloquent than I am. Thanks for watching, and don't go anywhere. This is the InfoWars Nightly News.
I really enjoy it when the globalists try to poison us, and we resist them via a free market system. Hello, my fellow InfoWarriors. Alex Jones here, introducing you to the ProPure family of gravity-fed filters. Now, you know that the globalists are filling our water with radioactive isotopes, fluoride, lead, mercury, arsenic. And one of the few systems that can efficiently and economically remove or reduce down to non-detectable levels these poisons are gravity-fed filters. And ProPure is the top of the line. Their filters are impregnated with silver, a natural antibiotic. On top of that, they're bigger, so they filter faster. You don't have to prime these the first time you use them. It's amazing. Go to InfoWars.com and click on the shopping cart link to see the entire family of these babies. Now, the fluoride they add to our water is so tiny that most filters can't cut it out. But ProPure has their system that will, again, reduce it to non-detectable levels, almost get all of it out of there. That's also available. And if you look at the different systems they offer, the ProPure big brush finish is on a stand, so it's easier on a table or at your restaurant or wherever you have it to go up with a glass or a mug and fill it up. Then there's this big baby right here, the ProPure King large version. Got a lot of different options that come with it. Also, they have the ProPure big, probably one of the best values out there. And of course, it's burnished stainless steel. And then what I use on my RV, something that's great for your hunting cabin or the back porch, is the ProPure Traveler. Small and portable, but packs a huge punch, cleans out all that garbage. They also have a glass sight spigot, so you don't have to take the top off and look in the bottom area to see how much water. You can see how fast it's filtering with this optional system. The globalists obviously are hitting us through our water. It's time to take control of our lives. It's time to not give our children and families these poisons. And these systems cut it down to non-detectable levels across the board. ProPure is the name. I only promote what I believe in. And I use ProPure in my home and my office. And I recommend that you check out the information on ProPure at InfoWars.com. We already have the lowest price at InfoWars.com on the ProPure gravity filter system. But when you add in the 10% off when InfoWarriors use the product code WATER at InfoWars.com, nobody can top it. So again, it's a win-win-win. Stop drinking the poison water. Checkmate the globalists when it comes to your health, and support InfoWars.com and the work we're doing here. You know, many revolutionaries rob banks and things and kidnap people for funds. We promote in the free market the products we use that are about preparedness. That's how we fund this revolution against the New World Order in our move to restore our constitutional republic and a spirit of 1776 worldwide. Check it out at InfoWars.com. ProPure, top of the line, number one, most powerful and effective and economical gravity-fed water system in the world. ProPure, available, discounted at InfoWars.com. Don't forget product code WATER to save 10%. It's the latest generation, years in development. ProPure is the name. And we are back. I want to thank Aaron Dykes for doing the news segment of the show tonight. And when I'm done doing this special report, Aaron's going to come back and interview our technology reporter, Jason Burmis, on the Kinect system that the Pentagon is now using. It face scans you in your own home and looks through your walls. Talk about Big Brother and how we're just inviting it into our house. That's coming up with Aaron Dykes and Jason Burmis after the next break. But first, I want to get into censorship. A few days ago, we wrote an article on Infowars.com that got picked up by the Drudge Report. Dozens of other big publications, European, British papers, U.S. News picked it up. ClimateDepot.com, Mark Moreno was also covering it, one of the first places we actually saw it. It's the sociology and environmental studies professor, Carrie Norgaard. And this story that got really big focused on the point that her paper said that climate skeptics needed to be treated for mental illness. And of course, treatment generally in this system means drugs. And if they're saying they need to treat us, that means in a psychiatric facility. This is what we saw in Stalinist Russia, Nazi Germany. They used the psychiatrist and psychologist as the secret police to say that person's mentally ill. They don't like the state. Arrest them. I mean, everybody knows about this. Well, there's been a new big development here. They have flagged and removed a video and told us that they're reviewing others and may ban our channel. And I have the letter that we'll put up on screen here from YouTube on one of our YouTube channels that has 190 plus million views. Of course, we're on XM. We're on over 100 AM and FM stations. But we do reach a whole different audience via YouTube. And now they're talking about banning the official Alex Jones channel because people complained about the video. So now if I get up here and call this woman authoritarian, call this dangerous, tie it into Cass Sunstein, the White House regulations are, who says fine, ban, or even go after people that don't believe in man-made global warming, he works at the White House. All of this is going on, and we have a site with 100 plus million views, 193 plus million views, and YouTube's now saying, we may completely get rid of your channel, and we're going to start erasing your videos. They have erased some videos. We have an article up at Infowars.com right now dealing with this by Paul Watson, that now, if you criticize the climate power-grabbing cult, your videos disappear into the memory hole. Now, I wasn't just talking about her in the video. I was mentioning Cass Sunstein, these other professors saying kill babies up to age 3 for the earth, kill old people, arrest climate skeptics, arrest Lord Monckton. This is what they're calling for. They're saying make it a crime like Holocaust denial. This is what's being pushed. This is pure authoritarianism. And so now preemptively, before I take legal action, which we're having to look at, we're having to remove a bunch of our own videos because they're saying, we get 3 of these, your site is gone. As we preemptively try to file motions and things through the YouTube system to try to block this. Now, remember, these are the people that say we're mentally ill. Others say arrest us. Others say fine us, censor us. The White House regulations are, says this, and it's beginning to happen. It's beginning to happen, and it is so creepy. I've been on YouTube 6 years. I've reached total over 600 million viewers in that time, conservatively. I have my Obama deception that's got over 40 million views on YouTube alone. They've pulled that before, and we had to file and get it put back up. But this has only happened 4 or 5 times. Now it's happening. Oh, and they said that was racism then. Nothing about race with Obama in that film. So they're scared. And they're coming after us. And regardless of if you agree with my speech or not, you need to defend it. You need to defend everybody's free speech. I don't agree with the Ku Klux Klan, but I defend their right to free speech. I don't agree with the new Black Panther Party, but I've got to defend their speech because that's the First Amendment. That's how our country was founded. Now, joining us is a former congressional advisor to the Senate, the preeminent expert in the United States, at climatedepot.com, just chronicling hour by hour, minute by minute, the absurdity of these people. And as their tens of billions of dollars of investment to bring in this global corporate fascist takeover through the Green Police, as it implodes, Al Gore has said, we've got to get desperate. We've got to, kids, tell your parents to shut up. I mean, they are getting more dangerous than ever. And just a few days ago, his video is now being removed and blocked. When he was on with us and other videos we posted on the same subject, he was warning that they were coming after our liberties and our speech and that they were going into a very dangerous phase. And now we're seeing it. These are very scary people, but they believe they're saving the earth, so I guess it's okay. We're going to go to Mark here in just a moment. I wanted to preface this in the special report, though, and I am breathless because we're seeing free speech destroyed in this country. It's YouTube. They advertise it as this commons. I didn't violate any of their terms of service. I read it right there, and they are now censoring us. And it's Alex Jones today. It's going to be you tomorrow. And it's because we're effective. Now, here's a short clip that got Fortune 500 sponsorship. The list is too long to read. This was a public service announcement. They were getting set to air. They screened it, and it shows people at their offices who won't make carbon tax acquiescence being blown up. It shows children. It looks like the sixth grade being blown up in bloody mass if they don't do what the teacher, a similar type, I guess, to this professor, you know, who's pushing this global warming thing. Well, they've got to be punished, and they're blown up. And who knows? Because I'm going to show you this short clip. Perhaps this video will be taken down, even though it's fair use, and I'm critiquing them trying to acclimate us with the image of violence. She's asking the kids, oh, you won't make a choice to cut your carbon footprint, not take a hot bath, you know, turn the lights out more often, you know, use less so you got more taxes to pay the super state and the bureaucracy. We're going to murder children. But we're not supposed to show you this. This makes them look bad. They'll probably ban this. Do you understand that? Let's go to this clip and then Mark Moreno.
Okay, class, thank you so much for today, and I will see you all tomorrow. Oh, just before you go, I just need to press this little button here. Now, everybody, please remember to read chapters 5 and 6 on volcanoes and glaciation. Except for Philip and Tracy, of course.
Shows players being killed, coaches being killed, men and women being murdered. The whole clip is on YouTube. But I guess it's okay on YouTube because the group put it out there and is very proud of it. So again, they're implying we're going to murder you if you don't go along with it. Because she asked the kids in the full clip. And of course, they'll try to copyright it, so I can't show you the whole clip here, even though this is news and I'm reporting on it. I'd have to go challenge it in court. Just go watch it yourself. She says, what changes are you going to make? And they all go, I'll quit taking baths. I'll quit this and that. And some kids go, I'm not going to make any changes. She goes, all right. And then it goes to all these other instances. Folks, these people, when you read their writings, they're maniacal. We have it posted in full in our article, Green Fascism, The Growing Threat of Eco-Tyranny, a key article that just goes through a smattering, a small sampling of them saying ration, arrest, shut down, censor, kill. And then we're like, oh, this lady looks like a kook. She looks like a nut. You're saying we're nuts. Oh, shut them down. Shut them down. Shut Alex up. Mark Moreno, this is totally creeping me out. I mean, things are moving so quickly that they've now banned this video and are trying to ban our other videos and shut down a channel with 193 million views. What do you think of this?
Well, first of all, I guess I should be honored. It's the first time I've been, add to my resume that I've been banned on YouTube now, based on our previous interview. What you showed was a 10-10-10 video, and it was from October 10th, 2010. And it's from a UK group, as you mentioned, corporate sponsorship. This was the global warming activist idea of humor. And it was a gory, graphic video that was on the level of Texas Chainsaw Massacre or something like that. And you're right. This is on YouTube. This was shown on television. This was directed toward kids. It involved kids in it. And this was their idea of, oh, this is just funny. Because the idea is, and this is what they can't stand. And even people like Tom Friedman, the New York Times, has been caught praising China's dictatorial policies because they don't allow dissent and they can just do what's quote like right for the people. They don't like dissent. They don't like anyone disagreeing. And this is what they wish they could do. And it falls in line, blowing up someone's head and blowing them up in the classroom, falls in line with what they've stated. Nuremberg-style trials for global warming skeptics. Crimes against humanity, if you disagree. Treason from Robert F. Kennedy Jr. It goes on down the line. These are not isolated cases. This is not, oh, just a little satirical video they showed. This was their inner impulse. And in terms of the, you know, the looks, if you will, of Professor Carrie Norgaard, it isn't her outside looks. It's, you know, people always say, well, it's the inner beauty. It's what's on the inside. And the bottom line is her views and her sociological studies are rotten to the core. They're ultimately anti-human nature. And all we're doing is pointing that out. And for YouTube, it seems to be here having a massive double standard to allow this kind of stuff. As far as I know, you can watch Robert F. Kennedy Jr. give his speech calling for treason for political figures who disagree on man-made global warming. That hasn't been pulled. But yet, you know, you question someone, start going after some of their what have been accurately dubbed totalitarian views and Stalinistic views. And there's an update, by the way, to that, Alex, which is even more Stalinist than we talked about the other day. That it's just, this is ridiculous on its face, and it is clearly, if you will, a witch hunt.
Mark, continue. Get into this new update, because they're now going into the memory hole and actually excising things in her paper.
Yes, what's happened is, since you, of course, highlighted it, we had it at Climate Depot, Rush Limbaugh's brought it up, the Drudge Reports featured it, multiple UK papers. This made international firestorm. The idea that global warming skeptics where something was somehow wrong with them, and that we were akin to racists and slave owners, and that, you know, we needed to be treated. Well, the University of Oregon, where Professor Carrie Norgaard, the sociologist, actually resides, decided that this didn't exist anymore. They removed the words treatment, treated from the website. It no longer exists. They didn't make a notation. They didn't make an announcement. They offered no explanation. Just poof, it was gone. And it goes deeper. Professor Carrie Norgaard's page at the University of Oregon, whoop, went missing. Era, 404 era, web, nowhere to be found. Her email address, gone, replaced with a private or some Yahoo type email address, no longer a university email address. And on my website, Climate Depot, we called this Stalinesque. This was rewriting of history Soviet style. Here you have a controversy, someone you don't like. She, I guess somehow the powers that be decided she was a liability at that moment for the global warming community. So they went poof and disappeared her. And this is just like on my website. I have a book called The Commissar Vanishes. Stalin, as different commissars in the old Soviet Union would fall out of his favor, would either be sent to the gulag or murdered, would then just new photos of them would appear with Stalin, and they would just be absent. Just no explanation, missing from the photos. And as time went on, member commissar after commissar would slowly disappear, and suddenly you just had Stalin standing alone. Well, that's what the University of Oregon was practicing, their amateur version of rewriting history. You don't like something? Oh, it never existed. It's gone. It's not there. Fortunately, Google Cache or Google Cache was there to find it, and you can, and that's how we actually have the screenshots and everything else. What's up with that? Aided in that, and we have all this up here. And it's a amazing development. Beyond that, ClimateGate professor Michael Mann from Penn State University, who loves to tout the fact that Penn State University cleared him of wrongdoing. Penn State University cleared their own cash cow, their $6 million global warming cash cow, of wrongdoing in ClimateGate, has come out now in defense of Professor Carrie Norgaard, and he's gone beyond the pale, and he calls her, quote, a very respected, responsible scientist. So the ClimateGate scientists are, some of them have come out and now are defending Professor Norgaard, as her own university is disassociating themselves from her, removing the word treatment, removing her webpage, removing her email address. This is right out of the playbook from 1950s Soviet Union.
Well, and I want to be clear, she's a public figure, and I rarely get into how people look, because I'm not the best looking, you know, person in the world. The photos, all of them, it's not even that she physically looks bad. She looks crazed. And I've had national TV show goofy photos of me and make fun of me. And I didn't call for it to be shut down. And I was simply, here's the lady saying we're crazy and need treatment. And I said, you know, here she is, because it's funny. And that was my only point. But then when you read what she's saying, it's very, very dangerous. It's this idea of they won't debate us. on the facts. They just want to silence us. And all of them constantly, I mean, you saw the articles in the last year out of England and Europe and even the U.S. where all these professors say, it's time for green fascism. In fact, guys, search the term real fast here on the fly. I mean, there were a bunch of them the last few years. You know, academic says, I'm sure you know the answer, but let's see if I know it. Academic says, you know, it's time to bring in authoritarianism to force it. What's the name of those? I mean, there's so many of them. Mark, who were they?
Well, just recently, we have Professor Lau from the SUNY, the State of New York University, came out and was calling for human engineering to combat global warming. And they're calling it, they're trying to say it's voluntary right now, but it's not going to be voluntary. Once they get this kind of technology, this is very frightening stuff. So we have this on the heels of that, where he's openly calling for psychiatric drugs to make us conserve more, to make us be repulsed at the taste and sight of meat. They're talking about medicating the population. They're talking about making babies smaller in the womb so that we have smaller carbon footprints. Out of England, and I'll just be posting this story, a woman was banned from going to her doctor. And she was actually thrown out of her practice because her carbon footprint was too big by how long she commuted. This is in the actual newspaper. We'll be going up on Climate Depot. This is the insanity.
Whoa. Let me stop you, because they're openly talking about not giving people medical care because they need to go ahead and die under the death panels for your carbon footprint. I've seen, you know, the New York Times say, hey, the recession depression is good because it lowers carbon footprint. You're telling me in England now, they're saying, hey, you can't come see the doctor because you're commuting too far. That's what they talk about in those weird Planopolis things they show kids, where people think it's a joke that we made, you know, making them look like fascists. No, this is what they really want.
Yeah, 83- or 82-year-old woman got a formal letter saying she no longer could go to the surgery center because it was considered too far in her carbon footprint. They urged her to find a closer one. They would no longer see her. The lady is in stunned disbelief.
But wait a minute. Prince Charles has royal trains, dozens of aircraft, but he says don't take a hot bath.
Yes, and that's right. And Al Gore has, of course, private jets and limousines. And of course, he says take city transit. Don't bother with, don't bother, with your own car, or, you know, you don't even drive a hybrid. He tells you to take the city bus. When was the last time Al Gore was on a city bus? And I'm not making that up. When Al Gore and Leonardo DiCaprio came out at the Academy Awards, they flashed on the screen when Al Gore won his Oscar, use city transit. They had these little helpful hints. When was the last time Leonardo DiCaprio was on the city bus? This is that idea that the, you know, the masses have one set of rules, and the leaders, i.e. the Politburo.
It's pure eugenics, double standard. They want us out of their way. The good news is they are being exposed. I mean, I'll be getting my hair cut and hear women talking about how it's all a scam, global warming attacks people. All the liberals I know have pretty much woken up to it.
Even President Obama now says it's not even possible to talk about climate change because the members don't buy it. So it's amazing. His fellow Democrats aren't with him. But the problem is they're doing this all behind the scenes bureaucratically right now. So even if the public rejects it, even if Congress rejects it, we're still getting it. And that's what we're getting through the unelected bureaucrats at the EPA. They're, in a way, they're having the ultimate final victory behind the scenes there. We've won every battle, but we're losing the war. That's the irony of this whole thing.
Because the system controls the dominant media. They control the systems like YouTube. YouTube, owned by Google, put a light bulb on Earth Hour up over the weekend. And at first, it had a light switch where you could dim your pixels. I guess the dark age is good for humanity, that Maurice Strong talks about, a post-industrial world. But then later, I went back for the second half of the day, and it was just automatically flipped to dark. So it's this idea.
They always start out by saying it's voluntary, and then eventually it doesn't turn out voluntary. We saw this with seatbelt laws across the country. Every state, well, it's just voluntary. You don't have to wear a seatbelt, but we're making it voluntary. And then cops won't pull you over for it. Then soon it became mandatory. This is the way they do it. And this is what this human engineering, along with what Professor Norgaard is talking about, you know, in the treatment. It starts out, they emphasize, oh, it's going to be voluntary. But guess what? Once you get into it, once it starts, it's not voluntary after it begins. And that's what's so scary about this. That's the history of government, history of people. But the most violent institutions throughout history have been governments. And people need to remember that when we empower governments and institutions with what they're talking about, the ability to do psychiatric drugs to make us like and dislike things, the ability to shrink ourselves to reduce our carbon footprint, the ability to tell us we can't go to a doctor because we're commuting too far and our carbon imprint is too big, the ability to regulate our shower heads, the ability to destroy washing machines with Energy Star regulations, the ability to destroy our ice makers, the abilities to take away SUVs because of carbon-based fares, the ability to control your thermostat, the ability to skyrocket your electricity rates. It just goes on and on. They literally will control every aspect of our lives, as the German climate advisor said, a CO2 budget for every man, woman, and child.
Hey, Germany, as you know, passed regulations that by 2020-something, you're not allowed to have a single-parent home. You've all got to live in communal homes. And Der Spiegel, I remember a few years ago, had an article like this was reasonable. I mean, this is total corporate Borg, pod people, crazy cult. And yeah, then I make a joke and say, look at this person. You know, she says we're crazy. She looks crazy. But like you said, hey, let's stick to what she says. The point is, it's still, she's a public figure. It's my joke. And they're going to shut me down for that. I mean, it just shows their authoritarian impulse is so frightening.
Yeah, and I remember it was Popular Science, I believe, a few years ago had an article, can we just allow people to reproduce willy-nilly? And their idea was essentially that the government would control sperm banks, and if a couple or someone wanted to have a child, you'd have to go apply for it, do all the paperwork, and the government would decide based on, you know, population numbers and economic factors and sociological factors, whether your area, whether you could actually have these children. This is just the impulse of the intellectual left, and it's been that way. If you look at the history of the 20th century, this is what they do. They think it's just bean counters. It's the arrogance, the fatal arrogance of this central planners. The more the plans plan, the more the planners plan, and that's what they have this impulse where they want to control all aspects. Regulating carbon is a wonderful way for them to do it. Upcoming UN summit in Rio is going to be regulating all aspects of our life. As I mentioned last time, it's going to cover endangered species, it's going to cover sustainable development. So they're going to be able to talk about the waterways, transportation, deforestation, agriculture. Every aspect of human endeavor will be subject to Earth regulations so we don't dishonor the rights of Mother Earth. And that phrase, rights of Mother Earth, has actually appeared at the most recent UN conference. We're not making this stuff up.
And really, it's just about them having a total power grab. We're about to end this interview. I know you've got to go, Mark, and get back to your work at climatedepot.com, but I did find one of those articles I mentioned. There's so many. Let's put it up on screen. Global warming alarmist calls for eco-gulags, his words, not mine, to re-educate climate deniers. And again, we went and searched, arrest climate deniers, imprison them, and we found dozens of professors, U.S., England, Europe, and it's all the same. And we have Dr. Pianca at the Texas Academy of Sciences getting a standing ovation when he said, bring in Chinese police state, arrest people, kill 90%. And now, I mean, I've seen one of the heads of the Green Party in England call for this. A Finnish environmentalist guru has gone further than any other global warming alarmist in openly calling for fascism as a necessary step. And he goes on to say, we will re-educate in gulags. We will do all this. We will arrest you. We will, discipline, probation, enforcement, and oppression. These are their words.
Yeah.
How they're going to oppress us. I mean, can't people see that this political correctness is a way to flog us into submission to these people? It has nothing to do with the environment, and it's all about their total will to power. You say we're winning the intellectual battle but losing the war because these authoritarians squat on us in their hippie camo garb. They're not even really hippies. They're just total control freaks. How do we defeat them? How do you see this unfolding? What can we do to defeat the greatest threat to human liberty?
Well, right now, the greatest threat to human liberty is going to be coming through the Environmental Protection Agency. And we need to defund the EPA. We need to cripple the EPA's ability to regulate these coal plants, to regulate carbon dioxide. And this is what's happening. Despite the fact that Congress failed to do anything, the United Nations failed to do anything, President Obama has the U.S. EPA now doing all the things that everyone else failed, but doing it successfully through the bureaucracy. And this is the way it works. Liberalism has so many options. The intellectual left have so many options using the power of the state. They put on the pretense that we have a choice and we can be all cheering. Oh, we defeated the cap and trade bill, the global warming bill in Congress. Oh, we defeated the United Nations. But yet it's still coming. It's still coming down the pike. They just keep coming, layer after layer, wave after wave of their nonsense. They don't give up. And we have to have, we've got to raise this to a national dialogue. I'm disappointed so far in the alleged opposition party in Washington, the Republican Party, raising this as an issue right now. And you have people like Mayor Bloomberg, the former Republican in New York, bragging that they're stopping hundreds of coal plants and their alliances with environmental groups. And now the EPA is joining them. This is the lifeblood of our society. I would also argue people like John Holdren, even worse than openly calling for these kind of totalitarian things, is what he did in the 1970s. He opposed Norman Borlaug, the Nobel Prize winning agronomist, the agricultural scientist, in his efforts to bring golden rice to Asia, which ended up feeding millions of people and brought people's life and fed people and helped and support people that would otherwise be alive today. This was John Holdren saying, we don't want better agricultural practices. We don't want foods that resist pests. We don't want all these people eating and living because the earth can't handle it. Openly, nakedly anti-human agenda. And where is history record John Holdren versus the man named the late Norman Borlaug? John Holdren, once again, is a chump of humankind and science, and yet he's still feeded.
Well, in the 70s, they said by 2000, we'd be in an ice age.
They said we'd be in an ice age. They said, we would have such massive famines from overpopulation. They live, and those predictions live to be laughed at. And as we've talked about, now the global warming alarmists have learned most of the dire predictions they make are long after the person making them will be dead. So in other words, if someone's 60 years old today, they're making predictions of the year 2075, long after they'll be dead. So they have learned their lesson to some degree. They try to make the predictions much further down the road.
All right. Well, let me just ask you this in closing. On the First Amendment issue, the fact that they're nakedly censoring more and more, not just calling for it, I think that shows how weak they are.
It does. They can't handle dissent or debate. Al Gore in 1992 declared debate about global warming over. Al Gore has never once consented to a debate. You have major scientists like James Hansen, who's never been involved in a climate debate. And all these guys, they claim there's no debate. They claim it's over. Michael Mann, the guy I mentioned previously, will not appear in any debates. Why? Because all the nonsense they spew would be destroyed within the first 5 minutes, and they'd be rambling incoherently, and they know that. So what they do is they try to suppress debate. This has been since the beginning. If you're an impartial viewer, don't know anything about the science, which side are you going to believe? The guy who's out there screaming, there's no debate, it's all settled, and all these people with huge credentials, Nobel Prize winners, former UN scientists, PhDs in chemistry and oceanography and climatology, all saying this is bunk, it's nonsense. And yet the people claiming it, the people that are funded with government blessing, won't debate them. This is why the public turns against them. They know it's nonsense. If you're going to buy someone's theory, you want to see the theory.
And they run around and lie. Just 2 years ago, they were still saying not one scientist disagrees, 100%. And it turned out the majority of those that had their name put on the UN thing as approving were just invited to the conference. It didn't mean they agreed with it.
And not only that, but they were anthropologists and sociologists. And it turns out that the entire report, it comes down to like 52 scientists, and give or take even less, depending on what part of the report, on the sensitivity of whether CO2 really, the kind of warming, global warming we should expect from rising emissions. It comes down to much smaller than that. And scientists at the UN have admitted that that's nonsense when they try to claim thousands of scientists have agreed. All that means is they've participated in this giant report, but in the report itself is just this big mess, but a close-knit group of 52, many of the ClimateGate scientists who reappear all over the place, came out and tried to shape the message that the science is unequivocal, and they actually had to agree line by line with UN bureaucrats and government leaders around the world. This is not a scientific process. One scientist from the UK said the United Nations is a political body masquerading as a science group. It's an abomination. It's the silliest thing you've ever heard for anyone to try to
play. Well, I mean, look how obvious it is.
Abomination. It's quasi-religious, so I guess abomination would probably work there.
Well, exactly. I mean, you've got a global government body with a bunch of bureaucrats that want more funding saying, the earth's about to die, give us all the power or you're dead.
That's and we won't debate anyone. We won't allow challenges. And we find that I have a whole report on all the scientists that resigned. We had UN scientists who sit in at meetings and say, we're going to make this next report so alarming that people will have to act. And they come out and testify to this fact. These reports were written before they even met to write the reports.
But look at all their defeats. I mean, there's just so much points here. But I mean, look at how they said the Himalayas would melt didn't happen.
Look at climate expo today. From 5 years ago, the Arctic ice has now gained the combined size of the state of Texas and Oklahoma combined for the same date in 2007. That's how much expanded ice we're getting from the, quote, rapidly death spiral.
And it was supposed to be all gone, right, by last year?
That's right. There were many predictions, 2010, 2012, 2014, that all Arctic ice. And now global sea ice is now greater than it was in the 1980s, before most of this hysteria started. In fact, it's greater today, this week, than it was in most of the years of the 1980s on this date. Global sea ice, if you combine the North and South.
Listen, folks, we better use the internet and free speech and defend it or lose it. ClimateDepot.com. Get that address out to everybody. Mark Moreno, thanks for joining us on short notice with this development, and we really appreciate the work you're doing.
Thank you, Alex. We don't know if anyone will ever see this video, but we're still doing it.
Yeah.
Don't know if it'll make the light of day.
Well, they're the boss. I mean, they said so,
Yeah.
We both need to be locked up in a mental institution.
That's right. And imagine if the government gets into regulating the internet now. And this is a scary world. The internet's the last bastion of freedom we have. And it's horrifying to think. It's one thing to even have, self-control. But now we're talking about, there's all various plots that keep reappearing in the United States Senate and the House to try to regulate the internet. And it's very scary because that can be easily manipulated.
Mark, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Alex. Thank you.
All right. There goes Mark Moreno, ClimateDepot.com. Folks, this is not a game and this is not a joke. OK, and I'm here to tell you the enviro power grabbers could care less about the environment. They never talk about toxic waste dumping or other stuff that's going on. It's all about the carbon dioxide you're breathing or that you're exhaling. It's a total and complete power grab. And remember Al Gore with the fake graphic of the polar bear that couldn't swim when it's the greatest land animal swimmer, period. Or they always show the North Pole, the South Pole in the summer, which is the opposite. Whenever the Arctic is in winter, the North Pole is in summer. But the point is, they'll show a satellite image and they'll show it in the spring and summer where every year it contracts. That's like the North Passage is available, from the United States over to Russia or Canada over to Russia during the summer, but it freezes up during the winter. That's why they have icebreakers. The point is they prey on the public's interest and they say, public, since you're ignorant, we're going to show you in the summer it melting and say, look, it's melting. It'll soon be gone. They don't show you the rest of the satellite imagery that in the winter it goes back. This is what the ice caps do. And so they'll point a camera at glaciers collapsing into the ocean and say, look, they're collapsing, they're melting. That's what rain does on the North and South Pole. And then it builds up and pushes out and flows as ice flows towards the sea. And always during the spring and summer, the glaciers are falling into the water. But they say, look, it's collapsing in the summer. Look, there's sea lions on the rocks where it was ice. Give Al Gore money. Give Rothschild money. World government. Look, polar bears can't swim. They can only swim 200, 300 miles. They say the polar bears are almost all dead. I keep saying their numbers have doubled. That's a conservative estimate. In many areas, there's fivefold. Look it up. Look up polar bear numbers exploding. They are the biggest liars. I was in a pizza place a few years ago, and they had children's local art projects for the environment in the entryway to this pizza place in Port Aransas, Texas. I was down there at the beach. And it was all penguins crying because there was no ice left and polar bears who were in the water and couldn't swim, who were drowned. And it was all these horrified children being terrified. And this is the type of garbage that we deal with. All right, that said, this is part of InfoWars Nightly News that goes out to our subscribers, airs on some cable systems around the United States. We reach on the radio 3 million people a day, 15 million a week, all total with podcasts, YouTube videos, shortwave, XM. It's going to be hard for them to shut me down, but they're trying. And I'm going to take this video right now. We normally wait a day or so before we upload it to YouTube. And I'm going to upload this InfoWars Nightly News special report right now. Because regardless of what you think about me and my views and my ideas, the fact that they're censoring the videos that we did and banning them and about to shut down our channel, the fact that they're doing this, and the fact that it's like the Soviet Union where some little commissar complains and they say, we agree, it's offensive. I can't even put videos up criticizing the TSA now. They take those down. You're like, well, go somewhere else. YouTube's over half the video views in the world every day. It's where the fight is. And it's a rigged game, just like Ron Paul really won those first states. They cheated him. We're still winning with the moral authority, but we're not going to be here if you don't support us. I mean, if I even told you about the dirty tricks behind the scenes, you know, the stuff that goes on here, you wouldn't believe it. I don't spend my time complaining about what's going on behind the scenes here. The death threats, the slap suits, all of it. Because I expect that. I'm over the target. And let me tell you something. As I get more and more over the target, you know, my grandfather was, like so many other people's grandfathers, was in World War II. He always told my dad, my uncle, he said, oh, I was a cook in the Army Air Corps. And he was a cook after his 22 missions. That's true. But after he died, many years after he died, they finally got into the storage there at the old farmhouse, got in the attic, and there were his annuals and letters and medals and awards. Because, you know, to people that have actually been in a bunch of combat, it's something they don't want to talk about. They're not proud of it, even if it was for a good cause. And I just think about the fact that there's that old saying when you were going over Europe that you knew when you got over the factories, you knew when you got over the military, you know when you got over the forces that you were over them because that's when you're getting the flak. The big anti-aircraft, toom, 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 shooting at you. And then flying through all that debris and metal. That's what flak does. It shoots up to the altitude of the aircraft, usually about 1,000 feet above, explodes with a bunch of shrapnel that's now moving at, you know, 500 miles an hour. And then that just rains into the aircraft as they fly through it. And so it's not fun. But as we get more flak, it lets us know we're over the target. The issue is, though, we need support. We need you to buy war bonds. And war bonds here, we're not funded by George Soros and the New World Order. We're funded by you, the viewer, the listener. We know the bankers are trying to impoverish. You know, I've talked to Jim Tucker and others. And every year at Bilderberg, they throw fits. They say, how can there be 500 protesters outside when we're in the middle of Switzerland up in the mountains? It must have cost them thousands of dollars to get here. Shut down the economies now. Make them so poor they can't protest. Feudal lords, going back thousands of years, get that. Make people so poor that they're so busy trying to get an existence, claw out an existence, that they can't resist you. And that's what this is all about. That's what globalism and fake environmentalism and eugenics and Agenda 21 is all about. Maurice Strong says, post-industrial world make you so poor that you can't resist them. I understand that. That's why we're fighting to cut taxes. We're fighting to put fair tariffs on China that the globalists have teamed up with to shut down our country. That's why I'm working so hard to defeat these people and risking my life. Because I realize there's no future if we don't beat them. But when you do buy the high-quality water filters at InfoWars.com, like ProPure, and get a 10% discount with the promo code WATER, when you buy the books, the videos, you get tools to wake others up, but you also financially support us. When you get a 15-cent-a-day membership or take the 15-day free trial and then decide to sign up at PrisonPlanet.tv, you're financing us. Because I have to deal with a lot of stuff behind the scenes, and it is the fact that you have supported us, that you've bought the books, the videos, the T-shirts over the years that has allowed us to do what we do. You know, we fund ourselves the good old-fashioned American way, free market, promoting things we believe in. Subscriptions, advertisers, books, videos, water filters, stuff like that. But it's not that easy. You know, when I get a slap suit, if I don't get the right lawyer, I just got one today. And if I don't get the right lawyer, and if I don't handle it right and deal with it just right, even though it's pure bull, they're going to win and shut us down. And I never come out here and basically yell and scream and whine and even tell you what's going on, because we're dealing with all the attacks on the back end. It's just, you need to understand, folks, we're getting a lot more flack. It's daily now. It's not monthly like it used to be. And we're only here because you're standing with us and right beside us and right behind us and in front of us. let me tell you, this New World Order is real. It's hardcore. And again, as we get bigger and bigger, as people realize that, wow, what these guys talked about was true, it's happening. As what we've broken down becomes evident to people, we become even more dangerous to the system because we've been proven right. Our credibility is going straight up right now. And the more famous I get, the more powerful I get, the more renowned I get, the more danger I'm in, the more danger my family's in, the more danger my crew is in. So when I ask you to support us, I ask you to support us so we can give the enemy the biggest fight possible, no matter where this leads. Because I don't mind being killed or set up or put in prison, and the FBI is circling around my office as we speak right now. All I ask is that you empower me and get behind us, spreading the word, financially supporting us, so that we can slam them as hard as we can. Because I don't want to fight these people in half measures. That's why I feel like a sack of crap most of the time, because I realize that I'm the best there is, even though I'm terrible, that I'm on the very front lines, tip of the spear, that I have got an incredible responsibility and opportunity for humanity here, and I feel every second like I'm squandering it. But I can't get down on myself because I'm doing the best I can. So I'm going to ask you to do three things for us. I want you to pray for us. That's number one, what we rely on. We don't believe in miracles, we rely on them. Providence. Pray for providence for InfoWars, the crew, and everything we do. And they put a hedge of protection up around us while the enemy attacks us. We got the devil's attention. We got Sauron's attention. We got the great eye's attention. Pray for us. Spread the word about what we're doing so it's not pearls before swine. And realize that we won't always be here if we don't defeat this. And financially support us. That said, I'm feeling really good because I've done my best. And I realize that, you know, it is what it is. But this is the real deal. Toe-to-toe with the New World Order. And I don't want you behind me. I want you right beside me. All right, we're going to go to break here and come back with Jason Burmes and Aaron Dykes getting into the incredible surveillance grid, the vampire of the New World Order we're inviting into our house, the Kinect system, and more. Straight ahead with Aaron Dykes and Jason Burmes. Another extended transmission because we've got the passion and the love of liberty. It's InfoWars Nightly News. Our biggest contest ever. And we're looking for people who love freedom and who want to be all in the resistance to tyrants. So you say you want to fight the New World Order. Why, if you were on the radio, if you were Alex Jones, you'd really kick some globalist ass. Well, here's your chance. We're hiring not one, but two new reporters whose reports are going to be on the radio, whose reports are going to be on the nightly news, who will even anchor the show. If you're ready, here's your chance to step into my shoes, and I hope you surpass what I've done. Two winners, $10,000 in prizes, and a shot to be a reporter inside the InfoWars.com command center. We're looking to hire one male reporter and one female reporter. And when you win $5,000. Your video gets seen by hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people on YouTube, and you get put into the very front of the running to be hired as a reporter slash anchor right here in our operation. Do you have what it takes to be the next InfoWarrior? The rules are posted below me here and at InfoWars.com. This is a big deal. You know, the globalists are expanding their global empire, but at the same time, the people are waking up all over the world. We've expanded our operations in the last year. We've added the nightly news 5 nights a week. We're making more special reports. We're reaching 15 million people every week. In a year, I want that to be 30 million. This is your chance to join the team. I want to see what you can do. But a big hint is this. Can your news piece make the news? Does it get people's attention? Does it educate people? Does it open minds? That's more important than being beautiful or speaking with perfect eloquence as an orator. All of that is important. But we're looking for people that have that magic spark, that fire of liberty in their heart, because I want you to join our team. I want to give you a launch pad so you can really take off and engage the globalist. And if this works, we'll have contests all the time, and we'll continue to build this operation. I'm involved in a talent search, looking for people who have the fires of liberty burning in their hearts and their minds. You've got until April 30th to complete your news report, and then we'll announce the winners 1 week later. Are you gonna join the InfoWar? Do you have what it takes? It's up to you. All serious entries will be posted on InfoWars.com. So everybody wins. You're getting the message of liberty out, and that's what really matters. But in the final equation, it's not about showing Alex Jones what you got. It's about showing the world and the globalist that no army can stop an idea whose time has come. Join me in the InfoWar. So you say you want to fight the info war. You say you want to go head up against the New World Order. You can do a better job than Alex Jones. I know you can. And here's your chance to prove your mettle.
We are back from break. We've discussed the shocking information about YouTube censoring us. We've discussed how the NSA is just building clouds of data on all Americans. And now we are joined by Jason Burmes to discuss how Kinect and other gaming consoles are being trolled by government agencies to collect even more data. Joining us now, Jason, thanks for coming on the show.
Well, thanks for having me, Aaron.
So break this down for us and talk about what's most important here.
Well, obviously, I've been covering the Kinect device since it was Project Natal on the InfoWarrior program over at InfoWars.com almost 3.5 years ago, Aaron. And now it's developed into a device that is literally in over 10 million homes. And by last count, there are about 18 million of these things on the market. And for those unfamiliar, not only does this have a 640 by 480 VGA camera that can obviously take pictures and video much like we see, it's also got a motion sensor and an infrared sensor as well, so it can map out the area and have facial recognition and motion recognition on multiple partners. And one of the articles that came out right around the launch of this thing was Kinect's future, a game controller in everything. And the lead developer there, Alex Kipman, kind of bragged and said that he was getting daily phone calls from the military, the healthcare industry, and the mobile phone industry on how they could utilize this technology as well. And in my mind, right there, alarm bells went off. We've already had Google brazenly come out and say that they're going to listen to our phone conversations to better advertise to us. They've come out with a new terms of service, basically for all of their operating systems, their web browsers, their Android devices, where they can pretty much do whatever they like, whether it's legal or not. And even, you know, a Leviathan like the European Union, who I'm no fan of, has come out and said, no, Google, you can't do that. This is still illegal. So, you know, these types of things are continuing to occur. It was not a shock to me when just last week the military actually announced a program in which they would be hacking video game consoles. And of course, this spread through the web like wildfire. On top of that, the next day it came out that they would only be hacking foreign consoles. We should trust our government, Aaron. They've been so honest and open with us before. And in doing research into seeing who they gave this contract to, it's a company called Obscure Technologies, and they are extremely obscure indeed. They had no website, no email contact. It was very difficult for me to even find a phone number. And when I did call them, as you'll see in the upcoming report I did for Infowars.com, they immediately redirected me to the Naval Postgraduate Institute, where the first response of the woman I had called said, that story's not true. And then when I pursued that and said, well, what about the story isn't true? She said, oh, well, the blogs just got a hold of it and it ran wild on the internet. And I specified to her, I said, well, I'm not talking about any blog posts. I'm talking about both the Yahoo story and then the Kotico follow-up. And then she told me that she had a list of approved questions and answers and that she would send them to me if I sent them to this email address. And I asked her, well, who am I sending this to?
So nothing's going on, but then, of course, it's run by the Naval Graduate School on behalf of Homeland Security, in other words. But they just want to blame the bloggers. And, of course, they've got this whole Kinect technology to make the conditioning of being watched in your living room fun and interactive and like you're part of this game. And down the line, it's used for what we all know it's used for, surveillance.
Absolutely. And I'd just like to make this clear, you know, technology is a double-edged sword. Some would say even a multifaceted sword, but it can be used to both empower and enslave. You know, it can be used to entrap or entertain. And sure, this device is entertaining, you know, doing this story. I actually borrowed my friend's Kinect. I used it for the very first time. It was rather fun. But if you are going to put a device this capable of not only video surveillance, but audio surveillance on a multiple level, because, you know, it can recognize up to five voices at once with noise cancellation technology and these advanced algorithms. Unplug the device when you're not playing it. Unplug it from the wall. Unplug it from your Xbox. No longer let it be active whatsoever, because you are literally inviting a Leviathan of a corporation like Google into your home to not only better sell to you, but possibly spy on you for the NSA, for the CIA, for the FBI, sometime down the line, especially when you have somebody like General Petraeus, the head of the CIA, openly saying they're now going to spy on us through our dishwashers.
Yeah, and of course it parallels Alex Jones' warning for a decade that computers, TVs, all kinds of things were being used with hidden microphones, the available onboard microphones, the attached microphones, and other external devices to spy on us. He was ridiculed. It was denied. And now you have these open monitoring devices, and people have enough Orwellian doublethink to deny that as well. Of course, you realize that. Let's go to your report right now, and then we'll come back with more comments.
Hey everybody, Jason Burmis here reporting for Infowars.com, and we're going to be taking a look at one of the most intrusive and technologically advanced consumer devices that's out there today on the heels of our military openly saying that they will now hack video game systems through a company called Obscure Technologies. And we'll get into Obscure Technologies in just a moment. But the Kinect device by Microsoft is one in which three cameras are placed on this front plate device, one of which is an RGB camera, which sees much like you and I do, 640 by 480 in resolution, can obviously take pictures and video. And on top of that, you have a monochrome CMOS sensor and an infrared laser projector, which gets both facial recognition and motion recognition. Now, on top of that, the device also has a multi-array microphone for multiple voice recognition. and of course, ambient noise reduction. Now, this device broke all sorts of records upon its launch, and right now holds the Guinness Book of World Record for the fastest selling electronic device in history, selling 8 million units in just 60 days. And there are over 18 million of these units out on the market today as of January of this year. So essentially what you have in your living room is a spy device not only capable of tracking your motion, of taping your activities, but tracking, tracing, databasing, and even profiling yourself and other family members that may not even be using the device. In fact, I'd like to harken back to an article called Connect, A Controller in Everything. And in this article, one of the developers, the main developer, Alex Kipman, discusses how he would like the device to be the first step in a holodeck-type experience, and eventually have this device be able to recognize what kind of t-shirt you're wearing. For instance, if you were to wear a Cincinnati Bengals t-shirt, then they would take that information and then advertise to you based along those lines. What sports you enjoy, what teams you follow, what other activities are in your interest, so you can be a better slave and consumer. Kipman also discusses in the article how the military and big business calls him almost on a daily basis to see how they can implement this technology in their arena. And of course, this has now come into fruition with the military now openly hacking video game systems everywhere. And let's not forget, it's not just limited to the Kinect. They're going to be hacking PlayStations, Nintendo Wiis, and beyond, folks. So we have to be very aware of this. And let's not just stop there, because the Kinect has a future even beyond the Microsoft Xbox. In fact, it's going to be used to control the next operating system on PCs, Windows 8. In fact, I was actually able to demo the controls about 3 weeks ago in the mall. Now, it's already launched, but there's going to be a second Kinect, a Kinect 1.5 that launches this May. And again, your mouse, your keyboard, they're going to start becoming a thing of the past. Now, Microsoft has already foreseen this and bought in Skype. Now, by buying Skype up, they now have a way for people to communicate through video conferencing. Of course, this is built into the Kinect, and as it expands its audience, look for it to be used with other accounts like Skype. Let's talk about Obscure Technologies, the company that has gotten the government contract to hack video game consoles. When I went online to try to find out more about this company, it had no website and two very obscure addresses. This is what happened when I tried to call the company. Hi, my name's Jason Burmis. I'm doing a story for Infowars.com, and I was trying to get a hold of somebody from Obscure Technologies.
Hi there. Well, we have been asked to form press requests to the NPS Office for Public Affairs.
Okay. So who would I contact for a press request? Now, just to take it a little bit further, open source users have already really hacked the Kinect on levels never seen before. It's already being used to control things like Windows 7 and Google Earth and even Androids. And I'm not talking about your phone, folks. I'm talking about actual robotics that now mimic your movement based on the motion sensors in Kinect. So the sky is the limit for this device. But are you prepared to have a device in your home plugged in to the internet 24/7, 365 that could be easily hacked by not only malicious hackers out there, but your government as well? Especially when you have the CIA director, General Petraeus, saying that they will spy on you through your dishwasher. Therefore, your video game system is something they're probably already using. And we know through announcements from companies like Google, who now say that they're actually going to be listening in on your phone conversations, background ambient noise, to better advertise to you, that they've said that they'll use information from your webcam on your laptop. So I'd like this to be a warning to those out there with this device or thinking about purchasing this device, that when it is not in use, that you unplug it from your Xbox and unplug it from the power source, because you are literally putting a multifaceted spy device in your homes. Be sure to check out Infowars.com for the latest in tech news that affects your life today. I'm Jason Burmis. Thanks for listening.
Well, Burmis, first of all, great job on an exclusive report for InfoWars there. A lot of information packed in. The first thing that comes to mind is that Aldous Huxley Brave New World concept of people loving their servitude. The fact that the Kinect was the fastest selling, video game device in history, opened the gates at 8 million sales in, 2 months? Now at over 18 million sales. People are really eager to sort of share that information and try to enter more and more into that online world. So that's one major theme. The other major theme is the overall blurring between the military and these corporate interests. It harkens back to the early days when the CIA first began to become unleashed, and you saw really huge conflicts of interest, like CIA coups in Guatemala and other Latin American countries that were at least in part on behalf of fruit companies. People like Alan Dulles had dual roles in that respect. And now we see the military entering into these online realms, these private corporate realms, and doing their efforts there as well.
Absolutely, Aaron, and they're going to continue to expand. And not only was the Kinect the fastest selling video game device, we're talking electronic device in history, bar none, whether it's cell phone or any of these things. And let's talk about that expansion. You know, we talked a little bit about Google in that report, and we've talked about Google before. Well, Google has a thing called Google Goggles that kind of made some pretty big headway 3 or 4 weeks ago. People were like, oh, augmented reality goggles, this looks really neat. Well, they've changed this to call it Project Glass, and they've actually put out their first demo video. Forget about the fact that we now have cell phones with 2 high-definition cameras on them that can easily be hacked. There are countless YouTube videos of people being able to gain access to the audio even when the phone is not in use, as long as the battery's in, as you and I are well aware. Well, these augmented reality glasses are literally a virtual window into your life every time you're wearing them. They have video capability outside. You can take video conferencing inside in them. They have voice recognition. Literally, we are being set up to have 24/7, 365 spy devices mounted on our bodies. And one of the things I talked about in this report with the Kinect is this is going to be the tool to actually use Windows 8, which is undoubtedly going to be the biggest operating system of our time. Windows has dominated the market now for almost 20 years, with Apple just having a small share of the operating system market out there. Google's tried to come in. They haven't been successful outside of cellular devices and some tablets. But I'm telling you right now, the keyboard is going to be a thing of the past. The mouse is going to be a thing of the past. We are literally going to be using Minority Report style devices that are going to give a window into our personal lives, Aaron, like never before.
I mean, we say personal lives. Of course, we're grounded in the Constitution, Bill of Rights based. We have a privacy. We have a Fourth Amendment. They've been whittling that away for decades. And the fact that the NSA is building this gigantic spy hub really signals the fact that more and more they see us as a population, not as individual, free, sentient thinking creatures who have innate privacy, but more and more like we're just a data bank. We're a resource for learning how systems work, how a human population system works. Do you see that trend moving, and where does it go? It looks only like scary ground to me.
Well, absolutely. As the economy is really brought down in this country, more and more people will be looking for work, and more people will be willing to man this $2 billion NSA spy center that is intended for us American citizens. This thing is reported to it's going to be the size of 17 football fields, folks. 17 football fields, stadiums, is what they're saying. Just think about the last time you went to a football game, and now you're going to have 17 of those fully manned with personnel. What could they possibly be doing other than surveilling the general populace? And of course, there's stories breaking all the time right now. James Bamford, the guy behind Body of Secrets, the original publisher of the Northwoods documents that we've talked about in regards to 9/11 and beyond and false flag terror, has just done an amazing report on this. And as you and I know, Aaron, he's confronted Michael Hayden, the ex-head of the CIA, on our loss of a Fourth Amendment. And basically, he was just pushed aside when he asked that question. So unfortunately, I just see this moving towards this surveillance type of society where we have less and less personal freedoms, and those that try to rise up will be dealt with in a manner unbecoming of our constitutional republic that was once great.
It's crazy. And the idea of opting out, as we see with the TSA, it's almost a halfway honest thing, except it's a rigged game, and opting out just means you'll be groped in the airport context. Well, what about online? Can you opt out of these surveillance measures? I don't know. Even if you could, and even if it was an honest system, there's so many layers of it, so many different things we interact with, so many areas where Google alone controls the entire arena for debate in the online world, in these technologies. How could you opt out of such a large swirling data bank?
It's going to be very, very difficult. And with Google getting into the television business and many of these smart TVs already having apps like YouTube, and seeing YouTube become more and more of a television station and not just a user-based system for content to be uploaded to the world, they're moving in the direction of becoming a TV station. And of course, they are owned by Google. And we've already been warned about some of these smart TVs that are already out there with high definition cameras and voice recognition, much like the Kinect device. And this is going to be moving forward. You're going to see more and more of this. In fact, I would say within 5 years, I would say the majority of homes, at least 70%+, will have one of these smart television devices or something like it in their households. And most people, unfortunately, are not going to see the negative side to that. They're going to be like, I don't have to use a remote control. I can just say TV turn on. This is great. But in doing so, you are not only giving up your personal privacy, you're setting yourself up for a surveillance state that we don't want to be a part of, that free humanity should never be a part of, Aaron.
Absolutely. And of course, technology is a double-edged sword, but they are armed to the teeth. And for the most part, we're basically ignorant about the data fight, the fight for privacy, where it is out there. So we'd like to continue to support these kind of reports, groups like the EFF who are trying to fight for online freedom. And let's hope it continues. Jason Burmish, thanks for joining us, and we will speak to you in the future. That is it for tonight's InfoWars Nightly News. We'll be back again tomorrow. Thanks for watching, and please support us. We are under attack in so many ways, as you heard Alex Jones mention earlier. Good night. Good evening and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Aaron.